Okay, today we are looking at motivation and consumer behavior. How does motivation influence or influences the way a consumer relates with a product or behave or think about a product? Now, we need to define motivation, look at theories of motivation, types of motivation, and of course, consumer involvement. Of course, motivation is the inner drive that reflects goal-directed arousal. Now, if you have a consumer who wants to achieve a goal of maximizing satisfaction, now something must trigger him for him to be able to walk towards that satisfaction. That is what we call motivation. It's the drive. It reflects the goal-driven arousal. That is, a consumer have a goal to achieve something and then he is triggered by another force to make him work towards achieving that thing. So what triggers the force that triggers the consumer to move towards the goal he needs to achieve is what is called motivation. And of course, we have different classic theories of motivation. Number one is Freud's motivation, Sigmund Freud. Now, Freud's theory of motivation that they can ask you in exam, explain Freud's theory of motivation. The man is Sigmund Freud, the father of psychoanalysis. Now, the guy believes that human psyche is broadly divided into two. That's Sigmund Freud, the conscious and the unconscious. Now, he believes that the conscious is represented by ego, and that comprises of perceptions, thoughts, memories, and feelings. And then he believes that the unconscious is called ID. And of course, that has to do with the instincts and psyche energy at birth. That is, you know, how does a child knows breast, and yet you said he does not have brain? So that's what he called the unconscious, the ID. And so then, he believes that anytime you are talking about motivation, motivation is innate, is an inborn ability, is an inborn characteristics that, you know, that shows, and it is unique. That is, what motivates A is not what motivates B, because their psychological makeup are not the same. So according to Sigmund Freud, he believes that motivation is innate, is from within, is from birth, that is natural to human, that they will be motivated towards doing something or not doing something. So that's what he believes about motivation. So the central idea of Freud's theory about motivation is that motivation is innate and it is unique. Okay, after that, we have Jung's theory. Jung's theory further look at it that the unconscious mind of human is broadly divided into two, which are personal unconsciousness and collective unconsciousness. Now, he believes that personal consciousness, unconsciousness, are those past experiences that human has built over the years about a particular situation or a scenario, and that there's what is called collective unconscious, and that at every given point the collective unconscious always influences the personal unconscious. That is, most of the time people believe they tend to believe a certain thing over a given period of time, but after some time the collective unconscious, which is what happens every time that they are seen around, will now begin to negate the belief they have about a particular product, service, or situation. Okay, that's what Jung's theory is saying. So the summary of Jung's theory is that people have their personal belief about things, but over time, those things will change by the time they begin to see new forces or experiences that tends to change that thinking. Then you have Abraham Maslow's theory. Now, that theory is called the theory of hierarchy of needs. Now, Abraham Maslow believes that there are five stages of need of every man, and that is what determines motivation for them. Now, he believes that the first stage is physiological need. The physiological need is the need that has to do with food, clothes, and shelter. So Abraham Maslow believed that what motivates a man at that point to do anything is food, clothes, and shelter. That is, if a man wants to eat, where to sleep, and what to wear, if that is his priority, of course, whatever will motivate him to do anything will not go outside his physiological need. And then he said, after that stage, you have what we call a safety need. Now, you know, when a man begins to eat, and then after some time, he will have excess, then he will now think of saving. And by the time he saves, he will now be looking for, those things I have saved, how will I protect them? I don't want anything to happen to them. So then that becomes the next drive that will be driving him. He has gone above physiological need. He will now be looking towards safety. How will I be safe now that I have something to eat? And so he will be thinking of, my car, I must be looking for, nobody must steal it. Oh, my food, I must be making sure that thieves will not come and steal it. That will be his next drive, his next motivation. And then after that, he believes that the next thing will be social need. After a man has all what he eats, all what he wants to eat, and where he can stay, and what to wear, then he will now be thinking of how those things will be safe. Then he will now be thinking of socializing. He wants to mingle with people. And then he will be thinking of making friends. You know, a man that has not eaten will not be thinking of having girlfriend. But the moment he have what to eat, what to wear, and then he can keep some of those things safe, he will now be thinking of, let me socialize. Then at some point, that will be the drive of that man. That's what will be motivating him, social need. And after that, you now have self-ego. Of course, at the point where the man feels on top of the world, and then he feels that, he now starts selecting. He will not just mingle or socialize with anybody. He will have a class. He will start thinking of, I have a caliber. So that will be the next drive of the man. He wants to walk towards, belonging to a particular class of view or set of people. Then after that, you have self-actualization. When the man feels he has achieved everything in the world, so what next? That will be the drive of the man. So Abraham Maslow thinks that the need of man is driven at five different stages: the physiological need, the safety need, the social need, self-ego, and of course self-actualization. That each of these stages determines what motivates a man to do whatever he wants to do. That's according to Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of need. Then we have Murray's theory. Murray's theory is culture bound. And he believes that people rank needs differently. Now, Murray's theory is largely dependent on culture. He believes that the culture of people, the way they think, the way they see things, where they grow up, how they grow up, determines their needs, and therefore they rank their needs based on the way they feel about things. And of course, this theory was largely criticized, given the fact that it was based on American psychological behavior or need. And so Murray's theory that is culture bound, he believes that people's needs are ranked, people rank their needs differently. That is, the way Mr. A will rank his need is different from the way Mr. B will rank his need, depending on the stage or the level they are operating within the culture. I haven't said that the next thing we want to look at is types of motivation. Of course, types of motivation is talking about, if you are talking about motivation, something must be driving the person towards achieving something. And so you have achievement motivation. Achievement motivation is talking about, at every given point, some people are motivated by achievement. That is, what drives them to do anything they have to do is what they will achieve from doing that thing, and that is what motivates them. So achievement motivation. We also have power motivation. As some people have desire to control, and because they want to get control or power to dominate, that motivates them to do some certain things. So when what drives a man is to gain control, is what is called power motivation. Then you also have what we call uniqueness motivation. Of course, uniqueness motivation is that drive to be different from every other person, to be unique, to do things differently the way other people are doing it. You know, some people just like not to go in the direction where everybody is going. They just want to be different. They just want to be perceived different from others within their environment. And so that is what drives them to do whatever they do. And when that happens, you call that uniqueness motivation. Then we have what we call affiliation motivation. Of course, affiliation motivation has to do with relationship. When people feel, beliefs that relating with people will solve their problem, of course, they will be motivated to relate, to affiliate. And so that's what affiliation motivation is about. And then we have self-esteem. Self-esteem motivation is talking about that type of motivation where a person or an individual believes that it belongs to a particular class of people in the society or in the community. And of course, that drives what he or she does. That's self-esteem motivation. So they are only motivated to things that will give them self-esteem. And that's what self-esteem motivation is all about. And then lastly, we want to talk about consumer involvement. Now, you see, at every given point, motive needs to be understood before consumers can commit. So before anybody can, you know, commit himself or herself to doing something, they want to really search, what is driving me? What is the force? Why am I doing it? So every consumer wants to be involved. So consumer involvement is talking about the fact that motive is always clearly understood by every consumer before they are driven towards a particular goal or before they make move to do something. So that is what consumer involvement is talking about. Consumer involvement is talking about at every given point, a consumer understands perfectly why he is doing anything he is doing. Because in the first place, what makes him to be doing that thing is that he understood the reason why he was doing it before he started. And of course, that is motivation and consumer behavior. Thank you.